Stuart Dambrot, speaking with Alex Gabbay about his recent film and documentary, Just Trial and Error, which I had the pleasure of seeing the other day. And I'm very curious, Alex, about your upcoming projects. I'm sure whatever they are, they're going to be as beautiful and as intriguing as the recent film.
Thank you. The next project is part of the series on the mind. So the first one was about consciousness, the one you saw, and the second one is on empathy. Mm. And what I've done with empathy is, I mean, basically the idea came about because I was in Israel, and I was talking to someone there who had a gallery, and she said, "Oh, I'd love to see your film on consciousness." She said, "Sounds excellent." She said, "And I'll tell you what, my daughter would be very interested." And I said, "What does your daughter do?" And she said, "Oh, she's basically a neuroscientist, and she's looking for empathy. She's investigating empathy." And I was very intrigued by the fact that an Israeli neuroscientist, especially being in Israel, would be looking for empathy.
Ah, I take your point. That is interesting.
There's a sort of irony in it. So the film started with this sort of slightly ironic proposition. But as it turns out, a lot of research is going into empathy at the moment, from neuroscience, from social sciences, behavioral sciences, because empathy affects how we behave to each other. I mean, you know, how you understand another person. So it also has a very sort of political side, obviously Israel, Palestine,
of course,
you know, what happened in Rwanda, how we deal with genocide, what makes us commit genocide, how we can be so tender to each other and yet so awful. The question of whether it's an instinct or is it something that's learned. Can you teach empathy to people? Can you influence people to sort of look again more empathically?
I was at a conference this past Sunday on some of these issues, and there were some films by a researcher. And this was more or less mirror neurons, learning, and so on, and what we're born with, what expresses from the genome, and what's learned. And there were two little bits, both with a very young toddler, different toddler. And in one case, the individual was hanging clothes with a clothespin, and he dropped one.
And unprompted,
the young child got up, toddled over, and picked it up and gave it to him. And the second one was he was putting books away in a metal closet that had closed, and he couldn't. He was acting like he couldn't open it.
And the
child walked over, opened it, and looked up at him as he's saying, "Like, what's wrong with you?" You know, just. But the point is, it was a natural response, a prelingual natural response. So empathy is a fascinating concept, and I do get the irony. In that part of the world, I can also imagine it being used. If you understand the mind of another, that could be put to nefarious use as well.
Yeah, that, I mean, interestingly, that one of the problems is that most people think empathy is sympathy. They confuse the two. Sympathy is quite an old term linguistically. Empathy is only, I think, 100 years old, 150 years old. It came from German. And empathy is not sympathy. Empathy means I put myself in your shoes. It doesn't necessarily mean I agree with them. Doesn't mean I'm going to do anything about it. But it just means that I'm able to think like you, to be like you, in a kind of cognitive process. I can actually. So it's confused by that, and then secondly, empathy is a neutral term. So if you're empathic about a situation, you can use that. You can manipulate. So politicians can be empathic.
Quite right. Whereas sympathy, you know, just to extend the metaphor, is feeling bad for someone who has no shoes. So empathy then, I suppose, in this project, you might be touching on, for example, the research into mirror neurons.
Yes, we interview Victor Galesi, who is on the team, who was on the team who discovered the mirror neurons in macaque monkeys. But we try, like this last film, Trial and Error, we try to sort of cover it from different disciplines. So we look at behavioral science, we look at autism, for example, we look at psychopathy, we look at, you know, what there are a lot of people, for example, who autism, for example, is a spectrum. Empathy is a spectrum. Some people have more empathy, some people have less. Some people have too much, which is hardly talked about. Some people have so little that they have no conscience.
And when they're in the same room, it's incredibly painful for both.
Yes, probably is. So, I mean, for example, psychopathy is something that, if you have the recognition part, so you understand someone's in pain, but you don't have the sort of empathy part, the idea that you want to actually do something about it, then you have one part of the system, not both parts. And that can be quite useful, because if in society, if you're doing if you're in a job that politics or business or something where it's in your interest that someone else loses out, you gain, one man's gain is another man's loss, then having that sort of personality, being less empathic, works for you.
And before we move on to the third project in the Mind series, is there, in your view, or perhaps in the film, in the project, a differentiation between understanding in an intellectual sense the mind of another as opposed to feeling emotive state of another?
That's a very good question. Actually, neuroscience is proving that there is two processes, that we use both processes. Mm-hmm. The discovery of the mirror neurons meant that it showed that human beings will emulate the other. They'll mimic the other person. So if you're sad and you're sitting like that, I'll talk to you in the same way, trying to understand you, trying to mimic how you feel. So this idea of mimicry is means that emotionally we mimic, physically we mimic, and that is a sort of not a cognitive process. It's a natural process. Whereas we also rely on the cognitive process. And that, that takes us one step further to understand, which is something that animals generally don't do. Animals can emotionally connect, but they don't necessarily work out why you're feeling the way you've walked in, you're looking angry, why, where have you come from, what
right.
have you, you know.
They feel it in a certain way, but they don't analyze it.
No.
So this is remarkably akin, it just occurred to me, and tell me if I'm off on this, to the discussion about art and science, in a sense, in that the emotional empath is holistic. It's in the relationship between the two, whereas the intellectual, there's a distance and kind of a coldness, if you will, that analyzes but really doesn't have an emotional identification with that which is being understood.
Yes, I think that's a very good point. Yeah.
Well, I can't wait. What's the third project in the series?
Well, we're looking at various alternatives, but the one that I'm thinking to start on next is instinct. How do we make decisions? If we make quick decisions, are they, unlabored decisions, just quick gut feeling decisions? Mm-hmm. Are they better or worse than, intellectual processes that take a long time, rationalizing everything, and then finally coming to a decision? So I think, the role of instinct and how there is research into this in neuroscience. It also pans out across lots of disciplines.
That is also, so I really do see these threads, if you will, these themes running through your work, and I hope I'm not imputing an error. But that also, what I hear when you're talking is, again, this bipartite view of the brain, the mind, consciousness, whatever term we're using at the moment, where in one case there's emotional holism and immediacy and transmission. Mm. On the other hand, there's intellectual distance, a quest for objectivity, and a removal from the percept. And and perhaps a lot of our achievements, yet perhaps a lot of our unhappiness stems from an imbalance, if you will, the struggle between the two.
You know Cahil Gibran.
Of course.
So he has one quote, I think, about the mind and the heart. And he said, the mind is like, if you're in a boat, the mind is like the rudder that you can steer across. But the heart is actually the sail, the wind in the sail that takes you, and you need both to get across.
Well, on that beautiful quote, thank you so much for coming today.
Pleasure.